Animals seem to follow me.
We're completing our fifth year of the Barn Find Hunter series. In that time, we've met hundreds of people and literally found thousands of cars. But some cars stand out. And to me, it's not the value of the car, it's the value of the story attached to the car. So if given the option of going to a junkyard and looking at 3,000 generic cars or going to somebody's garage with a unique story, I'll go to the garage any day of the week. So sat down and came up with my top 10 list. So we're gonna just rattle some off here. Starting with number 10, we met the Rev, who is a minister in Detroit. We met him, years ago, because we were attracted to the Cadillac and the old Chevys in his driveway. You know, just here's a car in a neighborhood in outside of Detroit. And we looked at the cars in the driveway and he opened the garage door and voila, there was two Jaguars, XK120s, a Roadster and a coupe, and a pink Cadillac that looked like Elvis Presley would have driven in on it. Here's a case where you can't judge a book by the cover. The cars in the driveway were okay, but the cars inside the garage were terrific. Number 9, Denny Hoxie, Traverse City, Michigan. He had a very similar passion for Jaguars. In fact, here's another one, Jaguar guy. But it was a story that he, as a kid, high school student, fell in love with Jaguars and ultimately wound up buying one as a young man and used it for years. And then, you know, the family came along and the farm that he lived on required more of his time. And the car started to break down, so he just, you know, took the motor out with the best intentions, and it's been sitting in his barn now for, you know, who knows, a couple of decades, and sadly he's now considering letting it go because he just doesn't have the time for it anymore. But I can really relate to that because I love these Jaguars as well. He was a real cool enthusiast. Number 8, who can forget Nellie? Nellie was a wonderful woman we met in Texas. She had a Porsche Speedster in the garage that had been in her family for half a century. And her husband courted her. He lived in Texas. She lived in Mexico. They got married, used the Porsche for fun events. Then they had a son and they went riding around as a family. But ultimately her husband got sick and passed away. The car has not moved in decades. She was a little bit down on her luck financially. And I found out about her through her son, and he invited us down to Texas to look at the car, and I really wound up meeting she and her son. They could have been relatives of mine. It was wonderful. Well, we did an episode on the car. She said, how can I sell it? We made an arrangement with RM Auctions in Hershey, Pennsylvania, brought the car up there, and the car sold for way more than, at least $100,000 more than I thought it would. It was just an amazing time, and she was able to say goodbye to her car, pay off all her bills, and live the rest of her life, you know, in comfort. Nellie got quite emotional during the discussion about the car. It was one that her husband came down to Mexico and picked her up in this car to get married. It's just an amazing story, and she showed me her wedding dress. She showed me a pen that her husband had sent to her that was the same color as he painted the car, which was orange. There was so much emotion attached to this. Again, another amazing story. A human interest story wrapped up around a car. Here, number 7, Terry and Preston were a father and son car collecting team that we met when we were up in Alaska. They lived in North Pole, Alaska, and they had a little bit of everything. They had Mustangs and they had Chevys, and the car that I really enjoyed in their collection was a Pontiac Firebird Trans Am that actually had been owned by Jim Wangers of Pontiac. Hey Preston, you are the perfect owner for my special 69 Trans Am. Take good care of it, Jim Wangers. He's the guy that brought the GTO to life and into production. So they had neat cars, they had project cars, they had cars that were just spectacular that they've restored or bought that way. I really loved the enthusiasm they had for their cars. Alaska automotive enthusiasts have a very short window to enjoy their cars on the road. And you know, they'll travel over the United States to see a car and maybe buy it and bring it back up to Alaska. Really cool, father and son. Number 6, was Marty in Bozeman, Montana. I had met Marty 2 years earlier. I happened to be visiting some friends in Bozeman and saw this guy's yard with so many cars. And I knocked on the door and I said, I don't want to see your cars now, but please don't touch anything. I'll be back in a year or two. And son of a gun, he didn't touch anything. I don't know how many cars he had, but I counted cylinders. And he had hundreds of cylinders. And as I remember, he had like 73 rotors, which were all the rotary powered Mazdas that he had, plus one NSU single rotor car. Great enthusiast. Cars that come to mind are a Nash station wagon that he had, which they got running for us. A BMW 2002, probably the first or second in the United States that his father bought brand new. All these Mazda RX2s, RX3s, RX7s, even a Stanley steamer, a steam-powered train that he was assembling. He was gonna put tracks around the yard. This guy had an imagination that just didn't stop. Really enjoyed spending more than one day with this guy, and I'd like to go back and spend more time with him. Number five is a gentleman I became really close friends with when I used to, for business, spend some time in St. Helena, California, up in Napa Valley, Russ Aves. Russ has passed on since we've shot this video, but this guy was a true American or California hot rodder. A 32 Ford coupe that he bought as a 15-year-old, he still owned as an 85-year-old. And this car started out as a stock 32 Ford with a flathead, and he souped up the flathead, and then he put a Studebaker engine in there, and I think he even had a Cadillac engine in there for a while, and ultimately put a modified flathead back in the car. It made it kind of a nostalgic kind of car again with multiple carburetors and high compression heads and headers, dual exhaust, 39 gearbox with Lincoln Zephyr gears. But he did everything himself. When he first painted this coupe, he used his mother's vacuum cleaner as a kid in the driveway and painted it. And since then, who knows how many times it's been painted, how many colors it's been. There's nothing this guy wouldn't try. And he's the epitome of a do-it-all, roll up your sleeves and I'll figure out how it's done. Just an amazing guy, and I really do miss him. And so glad I got to become friends with him for a while. Number four, Snowball Bishop, is a guy I met when I was writing a book about finding cars in the Virginia area, and met this guy who had a field full of old Fords, but it was really the cars in his garage and buildings that really were special. He had a couple of 64 Ford hardtops. He liked 390s, so he had one with a four-speed 390 and one with an automatic. But then he opened up this old shed, which was his original race shop, and voila, there was an old race car in there, a 37 Ford coupe. I couldn't get this coupe out of my head, and I brought my Hagerty friends over. We met Snowball Bishop, and we decided ultimately to drag that car back to Traverse City, Michigan, back to Hagerty's shop, and jump on this thing and rebuild it, and boy, it's a sweetheart. If you haven't seen that episode, I encourage you to go back and look at the Snowball Bishop episode that aired just recently. It's going to be unveiled sometime in the near future as a semi-restored, or let's say refurbished, old race car. 37 Ford coupe body on a 55 Chevy chassis with a 440 Chrysler motor and some parts from the Richard Petty garage. It doesn't get any better than that. Number three, top three. One of the first Barn Find Hunter episodes was in the Detroit area, and I picked up a lead on a Country Squire, a 67 Ford, you know, patina, a little rust on the hood, you know, the wood paneling on the side was faded away, a little rip in the seat here and there. It was a one-of-one car, I was told. A 428 cubic inch with a four-speed manual gearbox, bucket seats and a console, all in what was a kind of a luxury station wagon back in the day. And so we followed up that lead, and son of a gun, there it was. We did an episode about it. I found out that the owner, Adrian Clements, was moving from the Ann Arbor area to New York City, to Manhattan, and he had to get rid of some cars, and this station wagon he had to get rid of. And 3 months later, that car was in my garage. I just couldn't get it out of my head. It was so cool, and I owned the car for 4 years and enjoyed every minute of it. It had a very tall rear end, so it would go 100 miles an hour down the highway. You couldn't burn rubber with it, unfortunately, but boy, at 100, it was only doing 2,000 RPMs. Just amazing. We used it for a number of episodes, I'm sure you saw it, and I sold it to a very appreciative owner who picked it up at my house and drove it back to his home in New Jersey. And he called me up when he got home. He said, thank you for selling me such a great car. I loved it. I miss that car, but I hope to see it from time to time again. Number two was a gentleman named Billy Eubanks, and we met he and his father and his wife. And Billy was an amazing man who gave us access to his garages and buildings that were packed with cars like I've never seen. And these weren't just cars. These were cars that meant a lot to him. He bought them during the gas crunch in the 70s when big block Chevys and Hemi-powered cars, nobody wanted them. So he bought them for little money, restored them, and put them in a building, and got another one, restored it, put it in a building, got another one, restored it, put it in a building. He painted them. He put interiors in them. He rebuilt the drivetrains. He put new tires on them. And over the course of decades, those cars have kind of deteriorated somewhat. So we were looking at cars that were restored and turning into barn finds again. He didn't buy them because they were going to be valuable. He bought them because he loved them. Now they were very valuable. And it'll be interesting to see if he ever does part with any of those cars, but you know, there won't be a shortage of people that want to buy the 43rd Plymouth Roadrunner off the assembly line, which was Richard Petty's number 43, along with just an amazing selection of Cadillacs, Jaguars, Lincolns, a Lincoln that appeared in The Godfather. Unbelievable cars. So, Billy, thank you so much for allowing us in your building because it made my day. It made my life. It was the best barn find that I have come across in my life, so thank you. And the number one barn find hunter story, you know, if you look at this list, top 10 on down, do you see how many Cobras have you seen? How many Ferraris have you seen? We've found those cars, but they didn't make the list because I'm not really impressed by value. I really love U-miniature stories, and I love stories from people who don't expect that their story is very interesting, and it winds up becoming very interesting. So to me, the top one was the 62 Ford Country Sedan Station Wagon that we found in Tom Cross's yard behind his building, a car that we walked by once with our cameras, talked about cars, and we walked by it again, and we walked by it again, because he had probably 60 or 80 cars in his yard. And I said, do you have a rag and some compound? And I rubbed a little spot and it shined. And that car spoke to me. I said, man, do you have a buffer? And he picked up the car and brought it to his building, and we buffed out the fender. The reflection in there was just amazing. And here's a car that sat in the desert for 50 years, and that paint shined. And ultimately, we wound up buying that car, doing a refurbishment with Mexican blankets on the seats and a really nice 390 rebuild, a Ford-O-Matic, new tires, neat wheels, and that famous rusty roof that we just scuffed down and put clear coat on top. And we drove that car from Midland, Texas, 1,000 miles to McPherson, Kansas, and donated it to McPherson College of Automotive Restoration. Just a wonderful story. Tom Cross was a champ. He not only let us work on the car at his shop, but when we weren't there for months and months, he would work on the car with his friends, his hot rod club. He got donations of parts. Tom had not only his son help us work on the car, but his grandchildren. You know, the couple of appearances that I made there at Midland, Texas, I'd see his grandson, granddaughter, like helping granddad. It's multi-generational, and it was an amazing story, and the school is so appreciative to have this cool car as a parts chaser. You know, if they need parts for their restoration projects, they use this car to go get them, go to the junkyard, you know, pick up parts at auto parts stores. So that was an amazing time with an amazing group of people and a rather pedestrian car. Over the course of nearly 100 episodes, it's really hard to pick the top 10, but we did it. But we weren't satisfied. There were more, so we added one more, number 11, which we'll call an honorable mention. And it was an amazing man that we met in St. George, Utah, a man named Red Blake. So we landed in St. George without a single lead. And, you know, it took about a day and a half before we got traction. We met some car guys, and they told us about where cars were and backyards and whatever. But everybody mentioned Reds. They said there's an amazing junkyard on the far side of town. It's got a big fence around it. You'll never get in it. It's closed. It's been closed for a couple of decades. and a really crabby guy owns that yard. You'll never get in. So eventually we found ourselves on that side of town, and I see this old sign that said Red Blake's, and I look over the fence and oh my God, hundreds of cars. Wow. Now, I usually don't like to go to junkyards because there's no stories, but this is a junkyard that's been closed for 20 years. And if we could somehow get in there, I bet those cars could talk to me, or at least Red Blake could tell us about some of them. So there was an old tow truck with a phone number on the door. I said, well, what do I have to lose by calling that phone number? And it was a recording. And I said, you know, my name is Tom Cotter, and I'm driving around St. George, Utah in a 39 Ford Woody wagon, and looking for old cars for an episode we do called Barn Find Hunter. And maybe you would allow me to go in your junkyard. And I didn't think I'd get a call back. Or if I got a call back, I didn't think it'd allow us to come in. But son of a gun, that night at about 10 o'clock, I get the phone rings and it's Red. And he says, hi, my name is Red Blake. And you left me a message today. If you want to meet me at the junkyard tomorrow at 10 o'clock, I'll let you in and you can go around with your camera. Oh my goodness. Despite what everybody told us, all the car enthusiasts everywhere around town, we met Red on the phone and he sounded okay. We got in the junkyard where enthusiasts have been trying to get in for a couple of decades. We met the nicest man and he said, I only ask one thing. I don't want to be on camera. Okay, well, we like to interview the owner, but he let us meet Jimmy, who's an assistant of his, and Jimmy was on camera. And so we spent hours and hours and hours there looking at lots of muscle cars and unusual cars that have kind of been off the market for a couple of decades. Well, it wasn't too long after we were at his yard that Red passed away. I got a call from Jimmy and then a call from his daughter, and they said that Red's wife had passed away just a year earlier, and he died of a broken heart. He had just ordered a mid-engine Corvette, if you can believe that, a C8 Corvette he had just ordered. His daughter helped him find it. A spot on the assembly line order from some dealership, Chevy dealership, somewhere in the Midwest, and he bought that slot in the line just a day or two before that, and he just died at his home one night. And his daughter called me and said, I have to tell you, Tom, I've never met you, but obviously you and your crew left quite an impression on Dad because it was one of the most memorable days of his life. I said, are you kidding? He said, no, and he regrets so much that you didn't include him on the video because he didn't want his face on there. But after you left, he told me that he wished he had been part of that with his face on there. So I told him we did sneak one picture of him. You know, so here's a junkyard with a story, and not only any story, but an amazing story about a guy who was kind enough to let a bunch of strangers in. And little did we know that soon thereafter, if we had called just a few weeks later, he wouldn't have been there to answer the phone. So what a story. That's our top 11.